Before this episode, we want to take a second to tell you about Sturgis Credit Repair.
Whether you're getting released from Angola or just recovering from what life may throw at you, Sturgis Credit Repair can help.
With a fully automated online portal, it takes just a few minutes to fill out the request form and get started on your journey to better credit.
Chris Sturgis and the team at Sturgis Credit Repair are experts at guiding people to an improved credit score.
No matter where you are in the world, Sturgis Credit Repair is just a click away at www.sturgiscreditrepair.com.
That's S-T-I-R-G-U-S, creditrepair.com.
This is a story of America's bloodiest prison, told by the people who lived it, both inside and outside its gates. The brutal history, as you've never heard it before, from its origin as a slave plantation to its gradual growth as the bloodiest maximum security prison in America. To those outside its gates, it's known as Louisiana State Penitentiary at Angola. But to those who have spent time inside its gates, it's known as blood. Warning, Bloody Angola is a podcast covering actual events and is intended for mature audiences.
The subject matter discussed in no way reflects the personal opinions of the host or sponsors of this podcast.
Thank you.
Hey everyone, I'm Jim Chapman.
And I'm Woody Overton.
And we want to welcome all of you to the new podcast, Bloody
Angola.
Nobody can say that like Woody Overton can, I'm going to tell you. The first thing we want to do with this first episode is kind of have an introduction of what we're going to talk about, the premise of this podcast, which me and Woody both share a big affinity for, and that is the prison system, in particular state prisons, and even more in particular, local state prisons.
Right, right. And then the actual criminal mind.
Yeah,
said of it, even the free people, right?
Yeah.
I think this podcast was going to be so interesting because we're going to delve into things that and take you inside the gates of Angola, Bloody Angola, and tell you things that you've never heard before.
Right. And it won't only consist of the stories that that maybe inmates that have passed away now that Woody's going to tell and only the way Woody can tell it, but also an interview format podcast back and forth with people who may be still in Angola.
That's right. Or people who have worked death row, or people who have witnessed executions, or people who have been part of the riots. The one thing you're going to get on Bloody Angola that you'll get nowhere else, it'll always be different, and it'll always be something that is interesting and shocking, if you will.
Yeah, it's there's a reason it's even titled Bloody Angola. And Woody, you can kind of tell a little bit about that.
They actually, Angola or Louisiana State Penitentiary was known as the bloodiest prison in the world during the early 70s. So it was actually called Bloody Angola.
Yeah. And a lot of, you know, a lot of rape, a lot of killings.
Right.
But guards and inmates.
Absolutely. And I think one thing most people don't know or are not aware of is you don't even get sentenced to Angola in the state of Louisiana unless you get 80 years plus. Okay. That means you're going to die there.
Yeah.
Now, most people there, approximately 5,500 inmates, over 5,000 have at least one life sentence.
Yeah. Yeah. But wrap your mind around that. And so it's an atmosphere where a lot of these inmates don't have much to lose.
Oh, they have nothing to lose. I mean, how many life sentences can you do?
Right.
So what is it if you rape or stab a guard? And what are they going to give you? Another life sentence? Let's talk about the history and the mindset of the people, not only the people who get sentenced there, and that, you know, when they go through that gate, that's the last time they're ever going to leave unless they have a court appearance or something, but they're going to die there. And then the people who work there, a lot of them are generational. My mother was raised on what they call the beeline, which is where the free people live inside the gates of Angola. And it's just a whole different world. If I had one thing to share with the listeners, Jim, it would be that visual image and the smell and everything. When you go inside, the air doesn't even smell the same, and everything, it's a whole different world. The prisoners live by the culture. It's a whole different mindset.
Yeah. When you think of institution and institutionalized, Angola is what pops up in my mind, and you bring an interesting perspective in your, not only your family history, but for those listeners and viewers out there that may not be familiar with real life, real crime and, right, and Woody Overton, you bring a lot of experience in the law enforcement field to this podcast.
Yeah. And I actually started with the Department of Corrections, and funny say institutionalized after, I left the Department of Corrections. And I used to say it when you were there as a guard or a CO, correctional officer, you're doing time. Really, you are 12 hours a day. The inmates or the convicts were there for 24 hours a day. But I would come to a door and you have to be buzzed through or use a key. When I left the Department of Corrections, I found myself in the public and I'd get to a door and I'd stop and wait for somebody to buzz me through because I was institutionalized.
Wow, that's amazing. Hey, y'all, if you have trouble of any sort with your vehicle, I recommend checking out Performance Tire and Automotive in Denham Springs, Louisiana.
Y'all, recently, on both of my trucks, I bought all new tires, had oil changes, windshield wipers, everything. I went and saw Ben at Performance Tire and Automotive, and he hooked me up.
Give them a call at 225-665-9885.
The best honest service you can ever find for your vehicle, Performance Tire and Automotive.
PerformanceTireAndAutomotive.com for more information.
Right there in Denham Springs, Louisiana.
So Woody brings a ton of that experience with him to this show. Me personally, I also have a podcast, Local Leaders, the podcast, as well as I produce other podcasts such as Real Life, Real Crime. And
Scorch Justice.
And Scorch Justice. I am the managing editor for them, and Hustle Makes It Happen.
Great guys.
Yep. So I bring that experience from podcasting, but also I am a lifelong historian, self-titled historian of prisons. In particular, just something that's always interested me, and I've done a ton of reading since I was 12 years old on the prison system.
Right, and then so you have a passion for it. Right?
Yes,
and I have the passion for it. I've been inside of it, but you have the historian's passion for it.
Yeah,
and what on today's episode, y'all are going to get a taste of that because Jim brought research and found things that I didn't even know about it, Bloody Angola before. Was Bloody Angola.
Yeah, and I think the main takeaway you're going to get from the majority, if not all of these podcasts, is a unique look you will not find anywhere else in the media realm. This is something that, believe it or not, I researched for a long time to kind of see if I could find a show that's similar. It doesn't exist.
That's right.
I couldn't find anything. So I guess sit back, relax, and get ready as we kind of dive into a side of the prison system that you're absolutely not going to believe.
Yeah. And again, I can't make you understand enough how different of a world it is when you go through the gates and the things we're going to tell you. A lot of it would be shocking, but it's all going to be true. I told you, Jim, from the story inside and the research that he's done, I've known Angola my entire life. My family's there. Like I said, my mother was raised there. My grandfather was the first parole officer to ever live on the grounds of Angola back in the 50s. And my other grandfather was the prosecuting judge. If you commit a crime inside of Angola, like you stab somebody, you rape somebody, et cetera, what they call a street crime, you get prosecuted in the local jurisdiction. And my grandfather, my dad's dad, was the judge who handled those cases back in the 50s and 60s. But we want to start today with some fascinating information about how bloody Angola came to be.
What a lot of people don't know is that Angola, as you know it today, Louisiana State Penitentiary at Angola, actually started off located in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. And this was many years ago, 1835 to be exact. The walls, as it was known, were built in Baton Rouge. And there was a distinct reason for that, that was put together, Woody, and I know you know a little bit about that.
I do. The walls is what Angola was known as before it was Angola, right? And we'll get to why Angola is called Angola. But the walls in 1835, now think about that, that's approximately 30 years before the Civil War starts, right? And they always say you can judge your society by how you treat your inmates. Well, I guarantee you, I don't want to go to Angola. I damn sure wouldn't want to be on the walls. The Louisiana legislature appropriated approximately $15,000 to build the walls in 1835. Now, think about that, y'all. In 1835, $15,000 would have been like $15 million today.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a lot of money, right? But even though they appropriate the money for it, they use the inmates to build it. With mortgage rates seemingly on the rise often lately, you need someone with the experience to guide you through the mortgage process.
That's why we recommend Tiffany Seacard of A1 Mortgage Services.
With over 25 years in the mortgage industry, Tiffany Seacard knows exactly how to help you navigate the crazy housing market and advise you of every option available.
So whether you're a first-time home buyer looking to refinance or just need a mortgage company that cares about its clients, A1 Mortgage Services is who we use and recommend you do too.
For more information, give Tiffany Seacard a call today at 225-341-0660.
Or visit A1 Mortgage Services on the web at a1mortgageservices.com.
So the inmates actually made the bricks by hand to build the walls that made it the walls.
That's right. And to put that into perspective, and especially the time frame, this is only 40 years after the country was founded. This was a young country, as most young countries struggle with, they had crime and things like that, and they were locking people up, some for not right reasons. I mean, obviously, racial equality was non-existent in those days. So they found an overcrowding problem in New Orleans that was causing another problem.
Yeah. So when they housed them in New Orleans, it was so overcrowded, the health situation, it was – uncharted. People would just go screaming if they heard about this today, or if it happened today, like inside the prison, Orleans Parish Prison, whatever they called it back then, where they housed them. Then wasn't it? They had 10 rats for every inmate.
Yeah. So the just infested, it absolutely infested with vermin. And even back then, they did a lot of crazy things that we'll get into, such as convict leasing. How about that?
Yeah. That was a big deal.
They had a health issue there with, the rats were just pretty much eating the convicts.
Yeah, that's right. And they
10 to 1.
They'd be sleeping at night, wake up to a rat nibbling on your ear.
Yeah. Yeah. And look, even today, you can go to New Orleans, you see a rat.
Yeah.
Some of them are the size of people.
I know, right?
So imagine 10 of them.
No doubt. No doubt.
So they do. They appropriate this money, and they're going to build the walls. And that was built in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, and
downtown Baton Rouge.
Yeah,
on 6th and Laurel Street.
6th and Laurel Street.
Which used to be back in the day. That was only part of Baton Rouge there was. So it was a happening place. So to think about putting this state prison downtown where all the population was, all the business were, et cetera. That's kind of out the box. You wouldn't do that today.
As we've been saying throughout this episode, it's called The Walls. And the reason for that is what he mentioned earlier was the bricks were handmade by the prisoners. That was a way to save money. You know, even though they were appropriating a lot of money to this project in those times, that was a way to save some. And they actually built, you know, a square structure that was totally surrounded by brick walls. And the what really shocked me in the research of this was the size of the cells.
Yes, 6 feet by 3 feet. Now, look, I used to be 6'2". I'm 6'1 now because I've been shrinking. But 6 feet by 3 feet, dude, that's not even like a sleeping bag size.
Yeah, yeah. So they were stacking them in deep. So imagine those conditions. Kind of take yourself back to that day. Look.
No electricity.
No electricity.
No running water.
No AC. No nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And these prisoners are just stacked in deep to get them out of New Orleans. And the walls eventually became built and started functioning as a prison.
Once it was built, what do you do, right? So, you know, can't just leave them housed in the 6 foot by 3 foot cell all day long. They do what, even this being done today at Angola, they put them to work.
Yeah.
Right. And try to make them pay for themselves, right? Because they, even back then, people hated a criminal and they were like, hey, use them up and it makes some money off of them.
That's right. And you know, what were the big commodities in those days? Well, obviously cotton.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Any textile.
Cotton, wool, whatever.
Yep. So what can prisoners do? Well, they can make lots of cotton sweaters or whatever.
It's funny you mentioned that. Where I'm from, East Feliciana Parish, back in that time, it still now has the oldest functioning courthouse in the state. But back at that time, they had a railroad that ran from Clinton to downtown Baton Rouge. And it was strictly to haul cotton.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's so these inmates could turn it into whatever, right? And sell it.
Yeah. And that was the way for the state to start attempting to make the walls self-sufficient.
Right.
That way they don't have to continue to pay for it. And people don't have to say, hey, I'm spending all my money on prisoners to house them in Baton Rouge of all places.
And they tried. And again, the taxpayers, you lock a prisoner away, you don't want to think about him again.
Yeah.
But you don't want to also think about, you know what, I'm paying all this money to house this dude. So even back then, they were trying to make it self-sufficient, but they failed, right? Hey, y'all, let me tell you about the newest, hottest place to be. It's Southern Rhythm Venue and Entertainment.
Right outside Denham Springs, Southern Rhythm Venue and Entertainment features the best live bands, not only in the Denham Springs area, but nationally, right there at their location.
That's right. Southern Rhythm is all new. It's been totally redone. It's under new ownership.
And they have a beautiful, beautiful facility. There's a VIP section upstairs on both sides. It's really laid out the way we like it, Woody Overton, with right. That wood look.
And we've both been there. We've partied there. We've gone and seen the best shows. I've been three times myself. And the service is great. You don't have to wait on a drink. The acoustics and the sound in the place are awesome. And Southern Rhythm always has the best bands. And the owner?
The owner, Steve McDaniel, will take care of you. Me and Woody both like to listen to bands.
Yes, absolutely. And Steve's a great guy. I think when you go there and you see what they've done with this place, you'll be so impressed. And it's local. It's awesome. And I got to throw this in there. You got to try the pickle shots.
Yes, you definitely got to try the pickle shots. If you want a good schedule of the upcoming bands, they got a lot of them coming up. You can go to southernrhythm.com. And if you want more information, want to talk to someone on the phone, you can go to 225-571-7478. Give them a call and they'll take care of you.
And we'll be updating y'all with the new acts that are coming in weekly.
Yeah. And don't fool yourself into thinking this was just male prisoners. There were female prisoners involved. Yeah. Some estimated 5% of prisoners of the walls were female.
And the craziest thing that you found and I read and blew my mind, if you were a female prisoner inside the walls and you got raped and you got pregnant, that baby that you had became property of the state of Louisiana, and they would sell it. They sell it as a slave, and you couldn't be prosecuted for being raped.
Totally blew my mind.
Crazy.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this was obviously a long time ago, but it really wasn't. Not in the length of the history of this world. You know, you're only talking maybe four generations separate our generation from that generation. These people were having a baby in prison, it automatically, you don't own that baby. Right, it becomes product of the state.
I mean, like you said, though, the even back then, they were using inmates as guards, too. But if you were a female, holy shit, I can imagine. I mean, you know you're getting raped.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, guys get raped in prison every day. But if I'm if I'm a prisoner and is in 1835 and I can rape you as a female and get away with it,
yeah.
Nobody's going to prosecute you?
Yeah.
You'd be knocking out babies every 9 months.
Oh, I'm sure. And I'm sure a lot of these women just submitted to that, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there's nothing.
Maybe they used it as former trade or whatever. I don't know. But the fact, it was the law.
Yeah.
It was the law. You get raped. You have a baby inside the walls. We take your baby and we sell it. Now, y'all remember this before the Civil War when slave trade, unfortunately, as it was a very real deal.
Yeah.
And human beings were commodity.
Oh, it was awful. As the walls was progressing along, the state realized we got a problem. We're doing some things to try to turn some money over to make this prison self-sufficient, but it just ain't happening. So they had another idea, and this just really blew my mind, and that is convict leasing. So tell us a little bit about that.
So the first lease that the state entered into with a company was McHadden, Pratt and Company, all right? Yeah. And the prisoners were, McHadden and Pratt would pay the state X amount of dollars per prisoner, and that prisoner would go to work for that company, right? Naturally, it was the worst conditions it could be, and basically a slave again, but you're being leased from the state of Louisiana. They were forced to work under the harshest conditions. Let's say I was going to lease the prisoner, I would agree to house them and feed them and clothe them in exchange for their labor. But the rest of the prisoners who remained at the wall, they worked and maintained the prison grounds and manufactured clothing and shoes for prisoners in the factories. But the convict leasing thing is crazy.
Yeah, absolutely crazy. This is a state. The state leasing these. This ain't the black market.
State of Louisiana, I'm going to give you $5. I'm going to now own James for the year, and he's going to be my butler, right, or whatever they did with him. Who knows?
Yeah. I mean,
flip that back to you might want to lease some female prisoners and run a brothel.
Yeah.
I mean, shit, who knows?
I'm sure it happened.
There was no oversight. I can promise you that.
Like we say, a state-sponsored program where they would basically just lease them out to pick cotton, do whatever it is, dig ditches, whatever it is they needed done. And the state saw it as our biggest expense is to food and clothe these guys.
That's right. And then they wanted to offset that. So basically they did legalize, even if slavery was legal then anyway, but they legitimized slavery. Even the person didn't own the slave. I'm giving you X amount of dollars, state of Louisiana. I basically own this person. I'm going to house them. I'll clothe them. I'll feed them. I mean, if it was my person, mindset being back then, I'm leasing them. It's like leasing a car, like a rental car, right? Who is not going to trash a rental car? What'd they do to these people? Hey, y'all. Let me tell you about the ground force by the Cajun Navy. These are the people, the Cajun Navy, that stays after the storms come through. They're not actually pulling you out of the house. They help on that. But more importantly, they help the survivors of the storms. They give them food. They give them water. Everything that a person needs to survive that they don't have anymore after the storm happens and your home is destroyed and everything is gone, ground force by the Cajun Navy does it.
That's right. There's a reason they're called the ground force, and that's because they're the boots on the ground after the storm passes. They're the ones that kind of help you work through that confusion. And look, I know this from experience. In 2016, I was boated out of a house and I was brought to safety. I was in the situation where I didn't know where I was going to get toilet paper from. That's where these folks come in.
The ground force by Cajun Navy. These are the people, y'all.
That's right. So if you want to donate and give to the Ground Force Cajun Navy, it's easy. You can go to give.cajunnavy.org. You can donate via PayPal, credit card, and check by going to that website.
And they're a nonprofit, y'all. They're not making a penny off this. These are great people helping other great people. Survivors.
And we at Bloody Angola, we love to support our nonprofits, and this is one that we stand behind 1,000%.
Boom. Back it up all day long. Best people in the world helping survivors survive.
Yes, they're a new generation of disaster response, and look for upcoming really soon a new podcast by them where they're going to tell you the stories of these struggles.
My God, y'all. I heard some of these stories today, and it gave me not only God bumps, but made me cry.
Go to give.cajunnavy.org today.
Help save lives, people. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, just a crazy situation and continued for many years. And then, and look, this wasn't just limited to the walls. This went on in prisons all over the country once they figured out, wow, this is a way to make money. So, eventually the Civil War came along.
That's right. And during the American Civil War, the walls was occupied by the Union Army, right?
Yeah.
And everybody knows that New Orleans gave up pretty much without a fight. They come to Baton Rouge next, and the Union took over Baton Rouge. While it was being occupied, a musket ball landed in the prison yard inside the walls, and then they decided, oh, shit, we gotta get them out of here. And they shipped all the prisoners to New Orleans.
Yeah, so the problem was, shit, if they're going to start shooting cannonballs, musket balls, and all that stuff in the prison, these prisoners are going to escape.
Right, the thing is, too, they didn't want them getting killed because that was the source of income.
That to pay for very good point. Yeah.
And this, y'all, they stayed in New Orleans until around 1866 when the Civil War ended.
Yeah. Point. And now we're getting around to where Angola was born.
Right.
What they basically did was it continued with that convict leasing program. And they had a guy by the name of, he was actually a Confederate major. His name was Samuel James. And Samuel James basically went to the state and said, look, I've got a plantation. Mm-hmm. It is Angola Plantation. It's, I don't know if he told them exactly where it was located, but Woody, you can kind of tell them where Angola Plantation was located.
Y'all, for you, those of you who don't know, Angola Plantation was located technically in West Feliciana Parish, and it was thousands and thousands and thousands of acres. So what happened, y'all? It's now 1870. Civil War's over. You got no more slave labor, right? Lincoln freed the slaves. No more slave labor, but you had in the state of Louisiana is all this cotton. Now who's going to work it, right? Samuel James goes to the state of Louisiana, says, hey, I got a genius idea. Send me your downtrodden and dirty bastards, and I'll put them to work on my plantation, right? And so basically where the name Angola came from was most of the inmates or convicts that were there were from Angola, Africa. And that's where they got the name Angola from.
Yeah, that's right. So it was essentially just a workaround on slavery. So essentially you couldn't just go up to any person of color and say, hey, you're going to be my slave now or right. sell them. But if you were a prisoner, you had no rights.
Right.
Your rights were gone. And so the state basically said, you pay us some money and they can work your plantation and everybody will be happy.
Yep.
And that's essentially what happened. The walls, as it were known, kind of became a paperwork point, I guess, for lack of a better term. That's where these prisoners would kind of transfer into the prison system, and then Angola Plantation would in turn take them and put them in the fields.
And today that would be like Hunt's Corrections. Everybody that gets sent to the Department of Correction goes to Hunt first to be processed. So the walls back then kind of became the Hunts for the processing center. And of course, Samuel L. James wanted the laborers, right?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, there was an end game for him.
It was pretty much guaranteed that if you got sentenced to Department of Corrections back then, your ass was going to Angola.
That's right. And
so the James lease is what it was called. It ushered in a new direction for corrections in Louisiana, and where the conditions or accountability or transparency in the lease were ignored. The political officials didn't give a shit. All they knew is these guys, bad guys, were gone. We're not having to pay for them. Good riddance.
Hey, folks, if you're looking for a podcast out there besides Bloody Angola that you want to listen to, we got one for you. Hustle Makes It Happen, the podcast, is all about getting in between the ears and learning how to hustle like the most successful hustlers there are around.
Y'all, I've been a guest on this show, and they told me things or picked my brain apart and told me things about myself that I didn't even realize was true until after they said it. An inspirational podcast. If you're a hustler or you just need that extra little edge, go listen to the people that they interview. I'm telling you, it is my favorite podcast besides Bloody Angola. But the hustle makes it happen. These guys are true hustlers. They get it done every day, picking the brains of the people who they admire, the other hustlers.
That's right. And you can listen to them anywhere. You can go to Spotify. You can go to Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher. And they're also available on YouTube. And they get behind those ears and get to that hustle mentality.
So make sure to go listen, subscribe, like them, leave them a review, y'all. They are the hottest thing going. You will thank us later. I'm telling you, the hustle makes it happen. Totally different than anything that anybody else is doing. The hustle makes it happen, and the guys that run that love, love, love.
Yeah, they did a great job. So hustlemakesithappen.com. You can check out past episodes. You can listen, and there's video on that website. Check them out today. hustlemakesithappen.com. Yeah, that's right. And so that continued, and it worked out well for Mr. James, and so good, in fact, that it became known as the James Prison Camp.
That's right.
Instead of, Angola Plantation still had the name, but it was pretty much referred to as the James Prison Camp because he was taking every prisoner he could get.
Absolutely.
To work these thousands of acres.
Yeah, right? But not only that, the black inmates were subleased to other plantations as well as worked on Angola, but they also worked on the levees and railroads and road construction. But the white inmates who were seen at the time as being more intellectual were given kind of white collar jobs, if you would, as clerks or craftsmanship work and stuff like that.
It was, to put this plainly, folks, I mean, think about this for a second. It's the mid 1880s at this point. You're in South Louisiana. It's 150 degrees outside during a good summer. Yeah. And all you did, you had no rights. They worked you literally to death.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and under the harshest conditions, right. I mean, you can't get to a hotter place than South Louisiana in the summertime.
Yeah, and you weren't getting three hots and a cot back then. You were lucky if you got, what is it, like a pound of cornmeal or something they gave you today, and they had to cook their own shit. And then the conditions, I can only imagine, right, where they were being housed, et cetera. But let's take it back for a second. You have to remember, before the Civil War, one of the reasons Louisiana was so rich is because of the plantations. Everywhere you go, I mean, there's a lot more plantations that were bigger and more famous, like Homer's House and whatever, all the ones on the river, but they were everywhere. and they still are in East West 100%. Louisiana, and it's still agriculture is the main thing. But back then, there were no tractors. Shit, they couldn't even afford horses after the Civil War. But
Cotton gin wasn't even invented yet.
That's right. But they damn sure could get a sublease from James, right, and to have their place worked.
Yeah, and they're hand-picking this cotton. By hand.
Holy smack. And have you ever seen the pictures of that, Jim?
Oh, my God.
Long bags trailing behind them and picking and the hands bleeding. I mean, cotton is not something that's easy to pick.
Right? Yeah, that's right. And I'll tell you, I just went to Natchitoches recently. And to tell you, for you folks that aren't from Louisiana, obviously we have a huge population of plantations here. Right. Back in those days, cotton was the gold of today, I guess you could say. I
mean, it was white gold. That's exactly what it was.
Yeah, the commodity. So it was everywhere in Natchitoches even, which is not necessarily South Louisiana.
But it wasn't, so Louisiana picked the cotton, but it wasn't used, or so profitable for being used in Louisiana. It was, they manufactured it and they shipped it to Europe.
Yeah.
Where they couldn't grow their own cotton, right? Yeah. They shipped it around the world, and that's what made them so rich.
You had to have slaves or slave labor from something like a convict system in order to accomplish that.
Especially after the Civil War. Before that, you had generations of slaves that were raised on these plantations. Some of them were horrible and treated the slaves and whipped them and hung them and all that, but some of them treated them as family members. But they worked for them for generations until they were free.
That's right. They kept functioning this way for a while. And then I guess you could say some people got the red ass for the conditions that even these prisoners were under working in these fields. And look, probably obviously I wasn't alive back then, but probably a lot of those prisoners were in there for reasons that weren't even legit. The court system wasn't what it was.
You looked at a white lady shipping to Angola. I mean, that's the way it was.
Right? Yeah.
And again, the local law enforcement, it was an attaboy for them. They kept the status quo. State of Louisiana got the free labor.
Yeah. And those plantations, they had to have them to even function.
Like in 1886, the conditions for the inmates in Angola and the levee crews and the railroad work sites were so harsh under the James support and leasing. And James had the backing of the governor, right?
Yeah.
But he forced them to work harder and longer, and their deaths began rising. And finally, even the decent public, the decent folk were like, holy shit, this is wrong. Because they could see it. And that's when it led to the first prison reform ever in the state of Louisiana. And the association began in New Orleans by a group of concerned citizens who hated the convict leasing system, for which James had grown super rich.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, that was their bread and butter. And this group saw a big issue with that. And I'm sure, Woody, it was a situation where you got to wrap your mind around, they don't care. The James family or whoever the higher ups were in that organization could really care less. You were a prisoner.
That's right. You were a commodity.
Yeah. So their response to, hey, these are harsh conditions, is, well, it's a prison.
That's right. And they give just enough to keep them alive, keep them fed so where they can work and produce you money. Now, not only was James making it off of Angola, the thousands, I think it was like 18,000 acres back then. But not only was he making the money off of that, he was making it off all the subleasing to the railroad crews, the levee crews, and all the other plantation owners. Now, here's the deal. James is getting the money. Don't think for a second he wasn't kicking it back to the governor and the local politicians that protected him until this public outcry came, right?
I think that's where the key comes in. Right. Woody is the governor was his boy, right. For lack of a better term. They were boys.
I guarantee the governor had a few dollars in his pocket.
Oh, yeah.
The lease program, as was common back then.
Common everywhere. And so he kind of let them function, even though technically some of that stuff wasn't legal that they were doing, I'm sure. He allowed them to function because he was getting kickbacks.
Absolutely, and everybody was getting the kickback. But in 1898, they finally people were pissed off, and they came out with a constitutional ban on of convict leasing for the first time. So there were no more, you couldn't do it. 1898, the Constitution of the state of Louisiana stated no convict sentenced to the state penitentiary shall ever be leased. And that began effective at the end of James's lease term.
Yeah, so his lease comes up, and James is like, oh, shit. I can't do this anymore. They've passed this law, this lobbying group, you know, that is totally against me using this labor in this way, has now lobbied and stopped this from being able to happen anymore, the convict leasing program. So he turns to the state, and he basically says, want to buy it?
Yeah, no doubt, right?
Because he can't make money with it anymore. Right, right. If you don't have those prisoners, you cannot make money anymore.
That's right.
Because you... Yeah, folks, there were no machines.
That's it. They were the commodity. They did everything.
They were the machines.
They were the machine. They were the money makers. And in 1900, the state of Louisiana bought Angola Plantation from the James family, and the Louisiana State Pen at Angola was born.
And that's where it gets good, brother.
Holy shit. What do you say? This is a podcast.
142 years in the making.
Now think about that. Holy shit. Hey, y'all, you know my history as a career law enforcement officer. I'm going to tell you the absolute best criminal defense attorney in Livingston Parish and the surrounding areas is Brock Law Firm in Jasper Brock. His number is 225-686-7448.
Or you can check out his website at lawyerlivingstonla.com.
If I get in trouble, I'm calling Jasper Brock at the Brock Law Firm. You can take that to the bank.
That's right. And if I know somebody that gets in trouble, I'm still calling Brock Law Firm and Jasper Brock.
And if you have a family member or friend that is in threat of going to Angola,
yeah,
give the Brock Law Firm the call.
Definitely.
And Jasper has been doing it for over 33 years, y'all. He's simply the best.
Yeah, and think about this too. You know, 142 years, that's about six generations separating, you know, mine from theirs.
Yeah. It's crazy. My family goes back five generations in East Feliciana Parish.
Yeah.
So it's really not that long.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you think conditions improved,
no.
you'd be mistaken.
And it just began, right? I bet there were a whole lot of days they wished they would have been leased out on the railroad crews and the road crews and all that, because once they put up the fences at Angola and they put them to work, holy shit, then it became really bad, because James no longer, he sold Angola Plantation to the state of Louisiana to be used as the Louisiana State Penitentiary. So then the inmates, while they still worked them, they really didn't give a shit.
That's right.
They didn't care.
That's right. They didn't care. And so you may be wondering what happened to the walls. And it remained around as a kind of a paperwork point for a few years. Eventually, I believe it was 1919, they just went ahead and decided to tear it down. They wanted to make a development and I believe that might have been the courthouse in Baton Rouge, now the federal courthouse area,
right,
which was all where the walls were located. In 1919, they tore it all down except for one particular building, which you can still go see today, and that they call the Warden's House. People that hear this that are even from here, from Baton Rouge, will be shocked to know that there is a state penitentiary in Baton Rouge, right?
I didn't know. I've lived downtown in Spanish Town at a certain point, and as big as a historian I am, especially about Angola, I did not know about the walls.
Yeah.
I knew about the inmate leasing system and all that, but I didn't know about the walls. I certainly didn't know about the females being raped and being legal in Louisiana law. The babies became property of the state to be sold as slaves.
Yeah.
The conditions, crazy. But before the Civil War, the convicts ate and slept in those small cells, and which they call foot, they're 7x4 foot cells, and some were 6x3, but they had a 12-inch grate opening in a solid iron door, and they walked everywhere with a ball and chained at the ankles when they were outside the cell.
Yeah. Yeah, you didn't move without a ball and chain.
That's crazy shit. You think about that. People say, oh, the old ball and chain. No, you really didn't want to have that shit. A lot of times they would carry it. They didn't drag the ball behind them because it'd tear the skin on their ankles. So they really walked around with this chain and this 20-pound ball. I mean, you weren't going to run very far with a 20-pound ball tearing your skin.
Right? Yeah, yeah. You're not getting far. And look, the doors, it wasn't regular cells. It was big iron picture, iron a big iron door with a little grate that they would, I guess, pass your food through or whatever they were doing. But just a little small grate in there where you could see the outside world. And that was your world.
That's it. And unless you were fortunate enough to get out and work. That Samuel James, who ended up selling Angola to the state of Louisiana, but he had the lease assistant and everything, he was a Confederate major during the Civil War.
Yeah.
Right? So,
yeah.
There you go.
I mean, add that to the entire story. It all makes sense.
To how he looked at African Americans anyway.
Yeah.
They
were property.
They were property. That's right.
They were property.
So, yeah. And I said this earlier about the 1 pound of cornbread and wheat or some type of meal per day. Nowadays, they get 3 hots, and they have dietitians and everything. Everything's calorically straight and all this stuff. And actually, the prison food angle isn't that bad. But back then, holy shit, you got a pound of cornbread, you got to make it yourself. Then you got to fight other inmates to over the fire to make your shit.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that corn meal had a lot of worms and stuff, and I guess that was protein.
Oh, Lord. Yeah, good point.
But the outer walls of y'all rose 3 stories above the ground. And like Jim said, they formed a giant square. But the foundation sank 3 feet below the ground and were 5 feet thick at the base, creating virtually a barrier that you just couldn't get out of.
Yeah, which is exactly what they were aiming for. And just a complete square.
And they made it. Now, y'all, think about this for a second, because even the plantation homes, they were built by slave labor. You see the ponds besides these large plantations? That's where slave labor literally dug out the red clay, formed up the bricks by hand, fired them in an oven, and then they put them. Most of the plantation homes, the walls are 3 feet thick with bricks, hand-laid brick. The walls here, holy shit.
Yeah,
you weren't charged. You're not. You didn't have a spoon anyway. You're not clawing your way out of 5 feet thick.
Yeah, ain't no Andy Dufresne's getting.
Bullshit's going on.
Yeah, yeah.
But the guards back then, shit, they didn't play. Now, I'll get into the rules of guards and weapons and everything. But back to the walls again. While we're on it, the guards were armed with muskets and pistols and even swords. And look, they'd shoot somebody in a second. They didn't give a shit. There was no accountability. Like, you didn't have to write a report back then when you shot somebody.
No.
They were like, hey, prisoner, do such, such. F you, boss man. Boom.
Yeah.
You know, smoking like a pack of cools. other than they didn't want to lose their commodity, their labor.
That's right. That's what stopped them from doing it.
But
more than anything else.
As shitty as conditions were, each male convict wore a pinstriped uniform and was required to shave 2 times a week. And each one of them had to have a haircut at least once a week.
Yeah.
Shit, I don't shave twice a week.
I don't get a haircut once a week.
That's pretty great. Well, I guess they want to put a good face on their commodity. I don't know.
Yeah, and look, those pinstripe uniforms, just like you dress up for Halloween.
Yeah, that's right.
And you wear that's what it was, and that tough distinguished stuff. You as, hey, I'm a prisoner at the walls.
Tough stuff, tough times. And
yeah.
I don't imagine, I know once they got to Angola, most of them not only didn't get out, most of them didn't live
due
to the groups that did the reform to end the convict leasing system. I think their hearts were in the right place. They just made it so much worse.
Yeah.
So I mean, once you're confined to Angola and you can never be leased to anyone else, wow, what'd they do with you then?
Yeah. Yeah. You were essentially in the same situation.
But even worse, because you're becoming self-sufficient, if you will, and making the state some money grow off of the vegetables and everything that they grew. But the if you weren't, they didn't care. I don't think that it, where you went out in the public and you worked and you made that cash money every day for the state or the leasor, when you're an inmate behind the gates, if you will, in Angola, if you die, should replace them.
Yeah.
And I have another one coming in by horse and wagon next week, another 100.
That's right. Not only ladies have problems with their hormones being out of place. When I noticed my hormones felt out of line, I went to Flourish Hormone Replacement and Wellness Centers in Denham Springs.
Hey, I went and got my blood tested because my wife was going for to Flourish, and I didn't even know anything was wrong with me. And guess what? Everything was wrong. But Flourish took the personal time. Miranda took the personal time. Jennifer took the personal time with me, and they got my health even better than it was, y'all.
Yeah, and they don't just do hormone replacement. They do all kinds of different massages. They have vitamin B shots and injections to really get your vitamin B up there where it should be.
Yeah, and it's, again, for me, it's the personal attention. I've had them call me after hours when the blood work came back, after the doctor, after Miranda was studying my stuff, and she really, really cares, and they really go out of the way to give you your best health options. The hormone replacement is just the tip of the iceberg.
So we both recommend Flourish Hormone Replacement and Wellness Centers in Denham Springs.
Not only do we recommend it, we use it, y'all. I stand behind them 1,000% as health professionals and as people.
That's right. Check them out for more information on their website at flourishhormonereplacement.com.
Or give them a call at 225-283-1211.
And so we thought it was important today to really just set the stage of how Angola came to be.
Right.
Probably the most historic prison in the country, arguably. And boy, do we have some stories to tell you.
The one thing you're going to get, people, is the craziest stuff you've ever heard or have never heard before, and you never know what you're going to get week to week. But again, we started this week with the history. A lot of it I didn't know, and Jim rocked that. It's fascinating, right? But as we progress, and we may not always go in a chronological order, but as we progress, I think your minds are going to be blown. And you'll love every episode of Bloody Angola.
Yeah, everything from the executions to the...
But how about, y'all think about this. And this will definitely be an episode one day. I was thinking about last night, Jim. What is the last meal each one of the convicts ate before they were executed? Whatever you want.
Yeah.
They get their last meal. Yeah. That shit fascinates me.
Yeah.
And I have the list of everything. They have one inmate that's a trustee... Cool. That's assigned just to cook the Walking Dead, if you will, the one that's about to be executed.
Yeah.
That's all he does is cook their last meal.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's intriguing.
One of the many, right?
Yeah. And that's just one of the many, many stories you're going to hear.
Rapes. How about when I was in corrections, some of the worst, and I guess there's good and bad in every profession, but some of the people you worked with were worse than the convicts.
Yeah.
And those are the ones who, we're going to tell the stories about smuggling guns and one guy smuggling in a .22 pistol up his anus and gave it to an inmate or to a convict for a breakout. These are the stories you're going to hear that you never read about, never heard about. The kidnappings, the abductions, the rapes, the murders, the drug trade, how the convicts look at sexual relations. And I'll just throw this out there real quick. Naturally, you have a lot of homosexuals that are in there, but even majority of the mindset is, I'm a straight male. I can have sex with this guy. As long as I'm in prison, it doesn't make me gay.
He's gay for the stay.
Yeah, but not in their mind. And inside the prison walls, it's a whole different world, people. And we're going to bring it to you on Bloody Angola.
That's right. So look for it soon. We appreciate all y'all listening. So look forward to bringing y'all some awesome, awesome content on Bloody Angola Woody. It's going to be fun.
So excited, bro. And yeah. I hope we do it justice in giving all the listeners the inside and the walls of Bloody Angola.
That's right? It.
So anywhere, y'all, you can listen to a podcast, go like and subscribe to us and all that good stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Like, subscribe on all your social media networks. If you like this episode, please review it. Give us a little rating on iTunes.
Even if you didn't like it.
Leave us that too. We'll take whatever we can get.
And I can tell you this, in the episodes to come, y'all, this is going to be the most calm, generic thing episode you're going to hear on Bloody Angola, because a lot of stuff we're going to talk about is going to be really harsh.
Yeah. Yeah. We didn't want to give you too much of that goodness all in one episode.
Didn't want to send you running with your hair on fire just yet.
That's right. That's episode two. That's right. So thank y'all for watching. We'll see you next time.
Thank y'all. Love you. Hey, y'all, if you're ever in need of any type of mortgage specialist, call my friend Tiffany Seacard at A1 Mortgage. She is the absolute bomb and a dear friend.
She does everything from residential mortgages to refinances, and she makes it a priority to get you bought.
Give you that personal service you will not get with anyone else. You're not just a name with Tiffany Seacard at A1.
Go check out Tiffany's website at a1mortgage.com. That's A, the number one, MORTGAGE.com.
Or give her a call at 225-341-0660.
Quality service from A1 on day one. A proud sponsor
of Bloody Angola. Give her a call. You can thank us.